Good morning and happy Sabbath to everybody today. Let us pray. Father, into your house we've come today. By your invitation, and today we come before you to worship you and lift up Jesus. We pray that as we've come and as we lift him up, we pray that men and women, boys and girls everywhere would be drawn to you. Now bless everything that's said and done today. May it bring glory and honor to you, because we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated today in the house of the Lord.
Good morning, church family. Happy Sabbath. Try it one more time. Good morning, church family. It's a little better, so we're going to get there. Throughout the service, we'll get there. Happy Sabbath. I hope you all had a great week, because God has been better than good to you. Amen? Amen. So just before we get into our divine service, just a couple of announcements. One being the 2024 devotionals coming from the Women's Ministries. The 2024 devotionals are available. They are 50% off right now. So until the 30th of November, they're discounted at a 50% off rate. So that's the new 2024 devotional book. If you are interested, please see Elder Monica Walker or Sister Mary Lee Harris or Sister Dade. The payment will be due. And if you want that 50% off, then make sure you get it before November 30th. And also from the Women's Ministry as well, the Women's Retreat at Camp Kulakwa is coming up. So if you are interested in going to Camp Kulakwa, please make sure you are reaching out to our Women's Ministry leader, Sister Walker, or Sister Waverly, or Sister Dade. Anyone in the ministry, the Women's Ministry will help you out if you are interested in that. By next week, there will be more details on housing, pricing, and that whole weekend of extravaganza. The Women's Ministry, still coming from the Women's Ministry, it's a mentorship program for teens. So the Women's Ministry has invited Sister Barbara Francis, PA, to start mentorships from teenagers from 12 to 18. So if you are part of that age range, or if you know someone in that age, please let them know that we have a mentorship program for teens. And the Women's Ministry, they have invited Sister Barbara to come, all wishing to benefit from the value of an opportunity. Please meet next week, very briefly, on the Oregon side after divine service for more information on that. And also a few other events are coming up. We're getting into that holiday spirit. So we have in November, we have the Health Emphasis Day, November 18th. Mark your calendars. They have promised a day of everything from divine service to AY to movie night to s'mores to everything you could ever think of. So you want to make sure you're there for November 18th, right? Am I right? Or am I right? Right? Okay, so make sure you mark your calendars for November 18th. And if you do want more information, please see Sister Coriette, the Health Ministry's leader, and also put in an emphasis on December 18th. So you have two dates to keep in mind. December 18th is our Christmas celebration. Please make sure you are planning on bringing an offering that day. Planning ahead of time. December is next month. So let's be aware of this, okay? It's coming up very quickly. So please, December 18th, please plan on bringing an offering. And also, I have one more. I have a card here, and it's to the Solid Rock Church family, and it's a thank you card. It says, Dear Solid Rock Church family, please expect our thanks for the wonderful, glorious gifts to us on Pastor's Appreciation. We love you and we appreciate you for all your love and support. May God continue to bless each and every one as we labor for the soon coming of the King. Blessings, love, Sam and Annette. Dade. So last week we celebrated our pastor, and we thanked him for all he did. So they are saying thank you to the church family. Thank you, Pastor, for all you do. Of course, we wouldn't be a church without you. So thank you. And if I fail to forget anything in today's announcements, please refer to your bulletin. Everything that I have said is right there, so you won't forget it. And hopefully you won't forget my voice. I don't think you're going to forget my voice or my face. So please keep in mind those dates that I said today. Other than that, enjoy your Sabbath day. Feel God's presence here today. Hug somebody, smile at somebody. I don't know, just make somebody smile today. Something to, you know, uplift us today. Amen? Amen. Happy Sabbath and enjoy the rest of your day.
Happy Sabbath, church. You know, every week it gets better. It gets, the happy Sabbath gets stronger to the point where sometimes I don't think I have to even ask for it twice, but I'll do it this time. Happy Sabbath, church. Church, we are in for a service today. A service like no other. The Holy Spirit is going to move in a mighty way. And it's going to be unorthodox. So I'll let you guys know right now. Most of the time, we come and we have our band here. We have the music playing so that everyone can hear from the back row. And it's been a great experience. But today, you know, we decided, we said, you know, we want to try something a little bit different. Is that okay? Is that okay if we try something a little bit different? So today, I know some people, the drums are too loud and they're always disturbing your ears. We got our brother Jonas right here. He's going to be holding timing for us today, because today we need full participation from everybody, okay? And we're going to lift up a song of praise, but it's going to be kind of like the praise that you lift up when you're, you know, when you're in the car. Or when you're in the house sometimes. Sometimes you don't have the pianist behind you. Sometimes you don't have the bass player behind you giving you that groove that you need. And all you have is your voice and the Lord. You might have to stomp your feet a little bit to just keep the timing. You might have to clap your hands. But it's the message of the song that we can focus on. And I'm excited. I've never done this before. But I know when I'm in my car, and when I'm praising God by myself, when I'm walking around on the streets, my praise sounds a little bit like this. And we're going to share in that praise together, okay? So we're going to start off with this first song. This is it's not really a hymn, but it's a song that everybody knows. And it goes a little bit like this. I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory. How he gave his life on Calvary to save a, come on church, put your hands together. They heard about, and his precious blood, and his precious blood atoned. Then I repented, and won. Come on church, sing it to the Lord. Sing, oh victory, oh victory. Jesus, my Savior forever. He saw me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me and I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing. I heard about his healing. I heard about his prayer, of his cleansing power revealing. Then power, how he made the lame to walk again. And he caused the blind, and caused the blind to. And then I cried. Somebody sing, there, Jesus. Come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came. Somehow Jesus came and brought me to the... Sing it out, oh victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood, and he loved me, yeah, I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the, oh victory in Jesus, oh victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He taught me and bought me with his redeeming love. Let me hear you sing it, church. He,
come on.
Sing it to God. Come on. And all my love, he plunged, we're going to hold it. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. Are you happy to be here today? If you're happy to be here today, look to your neighbor and say, I'm happy to be here today. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. So first, we'd like to welcome our visitors. Are there any visitors among us? Please stand. We'd like to welcome you. Amen. 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 Anyone else? Anyone else? Okay. Members, you see our visitors. Please. Oh, okay. Are you a visitor? Please stand. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, yes. We see another gentleman there. Welcome. Welcome. All right. Members, you've seen our visitors. We're going to ask if you can greet them. Shake their hand. Go ahead. Nick, yes. Now's a good time for us to, you know, greet each other. We haven't seen each other for the entire week. Oh, wow. Okay. Okay. So members, I encourage you to get up, greet each other, greet the visitors at this time. So good to see everyone's smiling faces this morning. All right. Who's that saying that? Everyone smile? Who was that? Okay. we should have sang that. But thank you again for coming to our service. We pray that you are blessed. Welcome.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. Happy Sabbath to those on Zoom as well. Now that you have all been welcome, what a blessing it is for us to come together today to worship and praise the Lord. Isn't that a blessing? Sure is. And at this time, we're going to worship the Lord in our giving. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7 says, New English Version, each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. At this time, our deacons will wait on us for our tithes and our offering.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks for what He's given. Jesus Christ, His Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. And now, let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. And now, come on, sing it, church. Let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am. Because we're all thankful. Because of what the Lord has done for us. We give thanks. Give thanks.
Let us all stand for prayer, please. Before I pray, the motive or attitude with which we respond to God's call to be stewards is important. God wants us to give cheerfully because we love Him. Let us pray. Dear God and our Father, we just want to thank You for bringing us here safely to worship and to praise Your holy name. We have returned our tithes and brought an offering as You command. Please continue to bless us, dear God, and help that the tithes and the offering that were given may be used to further Your cause. Help us all to continue to give cheerfully, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Children of the world. Happy Sabbath, boys and girls. Now, the title of my story this morning is No Way Out. And it's about a young girl. She was about 16 years old. And she was very active in her school and in her class. Now, she was part of the basketball team, and the coaches, and they put a lot of time in her. She give her all when she go to play games. But something happened. She wanted to get baptized. And she would have, most of her games were being played on Sabbath. And because of her newfound faith, she don't know how to break the news to her coaches and her teammates. And she thought to herself, there was no way out. There was no way easy to tell her coaches, because as I said, the coaches invest a lot of time in her, and she was very good at the sport. Now, she decided, I have a little group up here, they're having their own story, but it's all right. You know. So she decided that just before she get baptized, she was going to play one last game on Saturday. Now the day came and finally she played. Now at around halftime, she find herself alone and she said, Lord, there is no way out. It's not easy to say this to my coach, to my teammate. So she prayed. And when she prayed, she like, Lord, you know, I don't want to continue in this sport. But I don't know how to tell my coach. I don't know how to tell my teammates. And for me right now, there is no easy way out. So after she prayed, something's strange happened. She began to run a high fever. And after the coaches and stuff, they came in and they checked her, her temperature was about 200. So they have to rush her to the hospital. I know. You see, there was no way out. 200 sound impossible, because we know in the medical term that's a dead sentence. But in God term, this is just a way of God working it out and making a way out. So as a result of her temperature running this high, she had to rush to the hospital. She was hospitalized, and after the doctors, they checked and noticed, they realized that she was born with one kidney. And as a result, they said that she could not continue in basketball sport anymore. So now her teammates began to sympathize with her. And now she realized it was God's way of working it out. When she saw no way out, that God worked it out, that there was a way out for her to be excused from the basketball court. She didn't have to break the painful news to them, and God allowed it to work out that she was able to quit the basketball team, accept the Sabbath, be able to worship on Sabbath, and as a result of that, she was able to find a new sport, and that was just after that someone gave her a guitar and she started playing the guitar, and now she find a new sport, something she could worship God and be more comfortable in. God, with God, all things are possible, even when we think there is no way out. Would like to pray for us. Let us pray. Father of love, we just want to thank you for this day. We want to thank you, Lord, that when there seems to be no way out for us, you always will make a way out. And we just have to trust you even when we don't understand. When we give all our faith and trust in you, that you will always make a way out when it seems impossible. Thank you, Lord, for being there and continue to be with us. In Jesus' name, amen.
It's now time for intercessory prayer. We'll sing
"There is a sweet anointing in the sanctuary. There is a stillness in the atmosphere. Oh, come lay down the burdens you have carried, for in the sanctuary God is here."
God is here. Can you feel his presence this morning?
Can you feel God's presence this morning? He's here. I can feel him all over me. And if I were in my former church, we'd jumping and shouting. But praise God today. If you're happy to be alive and on planet Earth, give God a praise this morning. If you're happy that you can hear me, say thank you, Jesus. If you're happy and you know it, what? Say amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Now I'm going to ask for about two or three burning testimonies or any prayer request, then I'm going to pray. Very quickly, one or two individuals, maximum three. Thank you. Amen.
Amen. I will ask them.
In mine too. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Amen. Anybody else? Quickly.
Yeah, good morning.
Morning.
Happy Sabbath.
Go ahead.
Okay. Mr. Sutler is asking for prayers, please.
Okay, thank you. Thank
for those who didn't hear, Sister Sudlow is asking for prayer. That was Sister Isabel. And what I would like to say, I'm so excited this morning because that was my former pastor. When I lived in Miami, Pastor and Sister Holness were at the Tabernacle Church. So I'm so excited to see them now. And when I saw the grandson leading out here, I said, but I know you. Of course, a baby then. And to see that the grandson, Pastor Holness, that boy is after your footsteps. Even though he goes up to do praise and worship, You could feel the anointing and you can feel the ministering in him. So amen, church, I'm just excited that, you know, it pays off when you serve the Lord. The rich example has impacted that young man and you could feel it. And now we get to benefit from it. Praise the Lord.
Okay, somebody's from the back. At the microphone, please. No, you also. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Okay, thank you so much.
Good morning, church. Hello. As most of you know, I left for boot camp like 13 weeks ago, and now here I am wanting to give thanks for every single one of you. I felt all of your prayers, and God was really there with me to the point where I could come back now and not say it was easy, but say it was manageable to the point where I didn't feel as much as the pressure that most people felt when I was there. So I just wanted to say a mighty thank you for everything you wanted, your prayers, your support, and your love. I felt it all when I was here. I really encourage us to always be grateful for all that we have, because sometimes the family that are around you, you don't really realize how much they are there for you until you don't have them in that moment. So I would like every single one of you to always be grateful and always appreciate people that are around you. Always be grateful. Thank you.
Look at that. Look at that. When God gets a hold of you, you got to shout. When God gets a hold of you, what happens? You can't keep still. Thank you so much, young lady. We're so proud of you. You did a great job and you changed completely. And everything.
Just want to give thanks. Ahead. Because the doctor gave my aunt a live. She's still living. So I just give thanks. And even though she's not getting an improvement, but she's still alive.
Amen, amen. Thank you so much. Sister Walker now.
Somerset family that has today. Sorry, I was a big, but I'm asking for a Somerset family. And one of my grandson had his birthday yesterday. I thank the Lord for everything and everybody.
I see one more person, I think, is in the back there.
I just would like to remind the church to pray for Israel. They are facing some rough time at this time. And it seems like the world wants to crucify Israel. But the Lord said those who bless Israel, he's going to bless them. And those who curse Israel, he's going to curse them. And so let us remember them in our prayer. Amen.
Okay, I'm going to be kneeling down before Almighty God. So please feel free to kneel as well, if you can. What a friend I have in Jesus, all my sins and grief to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, Father in heaven, so you're so amazing, so wonderful, so great and so awesome. We thank you, God, that we can kneel before such a wonderful God, a God that speaks and is done, a God that commands and it stands fast, a God that knows every single strand of hair on our head, a God that knows the name of every star in the planet, in the universe, the God that knows our thoughts, the God that knows us before we were born, and say, there she goes, I love her, I'm going to take care of her. That's the God that we serve, our mighty God. So God, we are sinners, saved by your grace. I pray, God, right now, you will cleanse us from every sin. Wash us, oh God, from our iniquities, and help us to know that you are with us, dear Father God. You want us to serve you. And what excites me so much is that you delight to be with us as we worship you. Dear God, you have given me responsibility this morning, the task of praying for your people and intercessory prayer. Oh God, you know me, you know my heart, you know what you have done for your daughter. So God, wash me and cleanse me, oh God, the prayer that I pray right now for your children. Let it go through your throne of grace. And oh God, let miracles be performed in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you, we love you so much. Lord, you have heard all the prayer requests that have gone to your throne. We're praying for Elder Sudlow. She was a stalwart for you, God, for many, many years in this church. She's asking for special prayer. Father God, I pray right now that you will place your healing hands on your precious daughter, from the crown of her head to the soles of her feet. Let her feel, God, your presence right now. And oh God, whatever the issues might be, you will, oh God, touch her and give her strength and healing, I pray, according to your will. I pray, oh God, for the Somerset family and their situation, God. You know exactly what's going on with that. Take charge and full control. And Israel, what's going on in Israel, dear Father God, you are faithful. You say that Israel is your land and you have bought them with your blood and also all of us. So God, your word is true. You said that in your word, that in the last days, perilous times shall come. The perilous times have begun. Help us, O God, not to be fearful, not to worry, but to remember to keep our eyes, our hearts upon you, and to be that minister, that child of God that can have light, your light and your salt to soften the world and to be that light in our dark communities. Lord, you know all the prayer requests that have gone to your throne, spoken and unspoken. So I pray right now in the name of Jesus Christ, every one of us here, we all of us have some prayer requests. Those who are sick, may God heal them. Those who have lost loved ones, please comfort them. Those who are in the valley of decision, please, one more time, two more times, dear Father, give them another chance to make their wrongs right and the crooked path straight. And those, oh God, who are on the fence, back and forth, not knowing if they're Christian or not, Lord, please cement that relationship with you. And those, oh God, who are on the point right now of giving up, dear God, I pray you will touch their hearts. Give them the comfort, God, to know that they are loved by you, oh God, right now, dear Jesus. Those who are experiencing depression, oh God, please go near them. Give them the strength that they need right now. Those who have financial difficulties, Lord, provide for them, because you are a great God, and thank you for your provision. I pray, God, for our church in a special way today. God, we can see how you're working. So God, continue to be with us, dear God. Help us to lay aside any weight, any sin, any bitterness, any anger that confronts us, God. And just let us look to the light of Jesus Christ. Because, oh God, you want us to be in that light So God, I pray for everyone in the hearing of my voice today. Anoint our hearts to be faithful, the school and the community, our families. Most importantly, Lord, give us heart like yours to trust and serve you. And the man of God, you have chosen again, Pastor Dade, that you'll anoint his heart, dear Father God, to bring forth your words as you have given it to him with power and anointing from the Holy Spirit. I pray all these mercies in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
What a beautiful moment of prayer and testimony. So, I know for me personally, in my walk, that's something that I appreciate about Solid Rock. Not many places you can go, and we take the time to listen to what the church is going through, the victories and the troubles that we all go through. I think it's just beautiful that we could all talk about it, because folks, when the church isn't the church with just this building, when the lights turned off, it's just a building. But when we all come together and the Holy Spirit, the breath that was breathed into us in creation, is when we can utter our testimonies and share our stories and uplift the name of Jesus and talk about other people's situations, it's just amazing, and that's what church is. So welcome to church this morning. Welcome to church this morning. I don't know what week people had or everyone has had, but for me, I know that I had a victorious week. I couldn't even smile enough to show you how much victory I got this week. I'm alive. We're all alive. We have Some people have food after this that they're going to tap into. We're here, folks. Let's, like the sister who shared, like we could be 6 feet under, but we are here. So we are going to put our hands together. We're going to put our feet on the ground and give a stomp. And we're going to give God's praise, because it's the songs that we're about to sing. It says, victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan, the devil, the liar, get thee behind. Victory today is mine. Come on, church. Snap, church. Come on, church. Victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Victory. Victory today is mine. Come on, sing it. Sing victory. Victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Victory today is mine. Come on, church, stand up. Sing joy, joy is mine. Sing joy, joy is mine. Joy today is mine. I told, get thee behind, get thee behind. Sing joy, joy today is mine. Somebody got a grandmother, sing peace is mine. Peace is mine. Peace is peace today. Peace today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Peace today is mine. Now watch this. Sing in the name, in the the name of Jesus, in the name, in the name of Jesus, we have the victory. Somebody go and claim this victory in the name of Jesus. In the name, in the name, Satan, Satan will have to sing in the name of Jesus, in the name of, in the name of Jesus. We have the victory. Sing in the name of, every knee will bow. We have. Come on now, everybody, church, let me hear you sing it. Sing in the name of, in the name of, we have. It sounds like somebody got victory. Sing in the name of, in the name of Satan. Oh, victory, victory is mine. It's mine.
Victory
is mine. Victory today is mine. I told somebody to say, I say, get thee behind, get thee behind. Victory, victory today is mine. And joy is mine. Joy is mine. Joy is mine.
Joy,
joy today is mine. I'm so happy because I told Satan, get thee behind. Joy today. It says, I'm so glad. I'm so glad that Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad that Jesus lifted me. Sing it, come on. I'm so glad that Jesus lifted me. Glory, hallelujah, Jesus lift. Cause tell me who can, tell me who can stand me for us when we call on that great name. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, we have the victory. Oh, tell me who can stand before us when we call on that great name. Jesus, and Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, we have the victory. We're going to end it now, just saying, victory is mine, victory. Somebody claim it.
Victory is
mine. Victory, victory today is mine. I told Satan, get thee. I told Satan, get thee behind.
I told Satan,
you can't stop me. You got on my side. Cause I've got Jesus. He's on my side.
I told Satan,
cause victory, victory today is mine. Hallelujah, church. Ladies, we can go with you. Folks, hold on to this message as we go on to the rest of our service. We're going to hold on to that message. A lot of the times in church, we can sing songs where we slow it down and it needs to be soft, but we're going to leave on victory is mine. Church, we have the victory. We are winning right now. The battle is already won. So just claim that victory in Jesus' name.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. On December 16th, we have a special program for you. So we want you to tell your family and friends and get them here because it's going to be special. We have these handsome young men, they will be singing. We have the praise group, they will be singing. And we're going to have a good time. December 16th, put that on your calendar.
Thank you. Shackled by a heavy burden, leave the load of guilt and shame. Then the hand of Jesus touched me.
We certainly want to thank Praise Team and the Solid Rock Men for ministering to us today. I want to say a quick word about Brother Jonathan. We had a dialogue a few weeks ago, along with a couple of members, Brother Jonas, and we met and talked and just went over several things, and I learned that he is a preacher. In fact, that next Sabbath, he was going to be preaching at Crest Memorial Church, and as you can tell, that the hand of the Lord is on him, and he has great spirit for the Lord, and could be anywhere today. He, along with these young people, could be anywhere today, but they have dedicated their hearts to the Lord, and we thank them, and we appreciate all of our young people, and we pray for them as well. And then I, looking out and I see my former secretary and his lovely wife, Elder Cleveland Holness and Sister Jacinth Holness. When I was in Southeastern Conference, Elder Holness was my secretary, and it's good to see him and his wife. And then I think we followed you in Port St. Lucie, and we were there for a time. And so it is good to see them today. And also to have, and I'm not sure what the rank is in the Marine Corps. I have a son who is in the Air Guard, and he's a tech sergeant. I'm not sure what the rank is for those who are in the Marines when they have completed their basic training, but we're happy to have Sister Coombs with us. Come on, say amen. And Brother and Sister, Elder and Sister Coombs went to their to graduation weekend last weekend. And I want you to know that the military does it right. You, whatever your views are about the military, I want you to know that the pomp and circumstance that they have, and when they do something, they do it the right way. And they will shower their military personnel with the accolades that we should do amongst each other. Come on, say amen. Because the day is coming when we're standing on the sea of glass, brothers and sisters, when we will not only see Jesus get his due, but we'll also be given a palm to each one of us, and we will cast our crowns at his feet. Come on, say amen. And we'll hear from his lips, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." So there is a pageantry that is second to none that we will be a part of when we finally make it to the kingdom. And so we are extremely pleased today for that accomplishment, Sister Coombs. And then I'm looking out and I see Brother and Sister Adams that are here. And I want them to wave their hands so you can see them. Brother and Sister Adams are members of the Filipino church, our sister church across town, and they are here. Sister Adams is a Medicare specialist, and you know that now we're in the open enrollment season, and there's so many voices. Every time you pick up the phone, there's somebody on the other end that is going to try to get you enrolled in some type of Medicare, whether you are of the age or not. Come on, say amen. You know it. You know it. And it gets to the point where every time the phone rings, it's that or it's a robocall from some others. But there are real voices out there that need to be heard, because you can make mistakes that will hem you in and take your money. And before you know it, you have been hoodwinked, you've been bamboozled, you've been run amok. That's what Malcolm X said. I'm just repeating what he said. And so you want to make sure that you're listening to the right voices when it comes to your enrollment in your healthcare for those who are post-working years. And I'm sure that on the 18th as well of this month, during our Women's Ministries Health Day, that you will be hearing different things that you need to be a part of so that you can make sure that your feet are heading in the right direction. I don't need to tell you of the unrest that you hear every time we turn on the news about what's occurring over in the Middle East, I'm reminded, as I shared with you last week, about don't panic. God has got this. He's in charge. And I really mean that. That's not cliche. The war and the friction that exists in the Middle East is nothing new. It goes back to Ishmael and Isaac and their descendants. And they've been warring then, and they will continue to war until Jesus comes. And that area over there is a hot spot and continues to be. And the people of God, even in the Old Testament, were constantly under attack by the Philistines and all of the area nations, constantly battling them for the land that the Lord had given them and promised them. And so as I look at it, I don't panic. I simply know that God had said it was going to happen. It continues to happen. And it will happen until Jesus comes. And so the thing that we are concerned with is for the loss of life, be it the Israelis or those other individuals that are a part of that turf over there in the Gaza Strip. We want to pray for them. It's terrifying and it's heart-wrenching to watch mothers and fathers uncover the remains of their loved ones and their children in the rubble. All you have to do is put yourself in their shoes. And they are involved, many of them, in a war that they did not start. They're in a war that they are not physically engaged in, but nonetheless, it reminds me of the war that we're in. Come on, say amen. We're in a war that we did not start. We're in a war that we were born into. We're in a war that wages all around us, but the hope is that there is victory as we sang today in Jesus. And if you don't know that, you need to find out that the victory is not in one side or the other side, but that the victory is in Jesus. And we claim that victory today from Jesus. I'm looking out and I see another colleague that Dr. and Sister Edwards are with us. Dr. Edwards, won't you raise your hand? I see him sitting in the back. If he had come forward a little earlier, he might have been tapped to stand behind the desk. But it's good to see you, both of you today. I want to talk to you today. I want to talk to you today on the subject of prisoners of war, survival 101. Prisoners of war, survival 101. And I invite you to bow your heads with me as we pray. Our Father and our God, today we give thanks to you for being such a merciful God to each and every one of us. Today we lift you up. And we ask now, Father, that you would come and fill this room with your presence, that we might get a fresh glimpse of you. And so I pray for your spirit to do his mysterious work as he moves up and down each aisle, in between each pew, whispering into each ear words of life, hope, and courage. Now, my Father, I ask you to be in my eyes and all that I see, in my ears and all that I hear, in my mind, give me wisdom, discernment, and understanding, and in my mouth, give me Holy Ghost power to proclaim your word, because I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You know how it is to be jet lagged. We are, Ann and I are road weary. We traveled after church last week, headed to the Carolinas, to Asheville, to attend and be a part of a memorial service for Pastor Haskell Williams' wife,
who died of a heart attack last month. And while Pastor Williams was here over at the Apopka Church on Votaw, he and another pastor by the name of Pastor Eric Duran and I became prayer partners. And we would meet once a week. We met during a joint workers' meeting between the Florida Conference and the Southeastern Conference several years ago and have remained friends ever since. And so we traveled to Asheville, and we're thankful for safe traveling mercies and for the Lord that took us there and brought us back safely. And so I'm a little weary. You know that when you, it used to be a time I could jump in the car and drive all day, half the night, and then turn around after that and drive all day and half the night coming back. But those days are gone. Somebody say those days are gone. You know, and in case you think that you can do it, I'm here to tell you before you start, those days are gone, and they're not coming back. And so every time we get behind the wheel and the Lord takes us on those journeys, we are thankful when our feet hit back at 16 Dingle Place in Apopka, Florida. And thus, I'm happy just to be standing before you today. So if I mince a word, if I flub a little bit, you just pray for me. Come on, say amen. But nonetheless, Prisoners of War, Survival Skills 101. If you have your Bibles, Daniel, the first chapter is the book and the chapter. And I invite you to go there. I want to read for you as you follow along, and it will probably be on the screen. And this is from the New King James Version of the Bible. In verse 1, it says, in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. That means he captured it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with some of the articles of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar to the house of his God. And he brought the articles into the treasure house of his God. Then the king instructed Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, to bring some of the children of Israel and some of the king's descendants and some of the nobles, young men in whom there was no blemish, but good looking, gifted in all wisdom, possessing knowledge and quick to understand, who had the ability to serve in the king's palace and whom they might teach the language and literature of the Chaldeans. Somebody say they were the total package. You know, sometimes when you're looking for a spouse, and I'm not saying it's all the time, I believe I got the total package. Come on, say amen. So, and I believe that some of us might be left with the spoils. You are just so grateful, some of you, that somebody even gave you the time of day and was willing to say I do before they said I do not, that you hurried up and got through that service. Come on, say amen. And thus you are married today. Well, these young men, as you can see, they were not just ordinary. They were the total package. They were bright. They were handsome. They were intelligent. They were just the awe of everybody in that kingdom. And verse 5 says, and the king appointed to them a daily provision of the king's delicacies and of the wine which he drank, and 3 years of training for them, so that at the end of that time they might serve before the king. Now from among those of the sons of Judah were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And to them the chief of the eunuchs gave names. He gave Daniel the name of Belteshazzar, to Hananiah, Shadrach, to Mishael, and Meshach, and to Azariah, Abednego. And verse 8 says, but Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's delicacies, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he requested of the chief of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Now, God had brought Daniel into favor and goodwill of the chief of the eunuchs. And the chief of the eunuchs said to Daniel, I fear my lord the king who has appointed your food and drink. For why should he see your faces looking worse than the young men who are your age? Then you would endanger my head before the king. So Daniel said to the steward whom the chief of the eunuchs had set over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, please test your servants for 10 days and let them give us vegetables to eat and water to drink. And then let our appearance be examined before you and the appearance of the young men who eat of the portion of the king's delicacies. And as you see fit, so deal with your servants. So he consented with them in this manner and tested them for 10 days. And at the end of the 10 days, their features appeared better and fatter in flesh than all of the young men who ate the portion of the king's delicacies. Thus the steward took away their portions of delicacies and the wine that they were to drink and gave them vegetables. Verse 17, as for those young men, God gave them knowledge and skill in all literature and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. Now at the end of the 10 days, when the king had said that they should be brought in, the chief of the eunuchs brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar. And then the king interviewed them, and among them all none was found like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore, they served before the king. And in all matters of wisdom and understanding about the king, of all times, my scripture wants to stick together. All right, here we go. In all matters of wisdom and understanding about which the king examined them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers who were in his realm. Then Daniel continued until the first year of King Cyrus. What a synopsis. What a beautiful portrayal of what it means to faithfully serve God. Daniel's life is a sterling example of how we can live a life of integrity in the midst of a heathen culture, in the midst of a hedonistic culture that is laser focused on the intent to squeeze us into a demonic mold. Whether we understand it or not, this world, this culture, is trying to squeeze us into the mold that comes from a demonic source. These actions exemplified by Daniel are not commanded. Instead, they are commended. Our task, our responsibility today is to take the timeless principles that Daniel lived by in the ancient cesspool known as Babylon and apply them in our own modern experiences in 21st century America. Let's examine some historical background in Daniel chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. As the backdrop for our discourse this morning, Daniel opens with two short statements about the invasion and capture of Jerusalem by Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon. The first statement describes the event in terms of secular history. Nebuchadnezzar came to Jerusalem and seized it. Now, I don't know about you, but I can't even imagine somebody coming from across the sea over and taking all of America captive. It just doesn't make sense to me. But here we find that the people of God, who had never fought a battle before, the people of God that instead of them picking up swords to fight, instead God fought their battles for them. Come on, say amen. When they went into war, even though they were outnumbered, God was able to turn the tide. He was able to make up the difference. He was able to become the majority. He was able to defeat the enemy. And sometimes the children of Israel didn't even have to do a thing but lift a shout. Walls came tumbling down. Red seas divided. That's the way that this story unfolds. That here they are in a situation for the first time in their history. They are taken captive. Now, I want to pause here because when it comes to taking captive, there were certain things that happened. Certain things that happened. And that was that whenever a conquering king came in and took a nation captive, what he would do is that he would put out the eyes of the opposing king, and he would lead him captive, chained and bound, and lead him to the nation where he was, of the conquering king. In addition to that, he would set up an outpost over the land that he had just conquered. And I'm told that the king, the conquering king, with every nation that he conquered, would tear a piece of the robe of the king's robe that he conquered. And he would put it, have it sewn on to his robe. And so the one who had the longest robe, Mommy T, was considered to be the one who was the one of conquest, and there were none other like him. But I'm told that when Isaiah looked in the temple, that he saw the Lord high and lifted up. Come on, say amen. And it says that his train filled the temple. That means that his train was so long that it filled the whole temple, because there is no king like our king. And he is a conquering king. Come on, say amen. And so this particular situation, this setting here, where Nebuchadnezzar took took Jerusalem by siege, describes the event in terms of secular history. The second statement is in terms of biblical theology. Biblical theology. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim into his hands. I found that to be most striking. How God can employ a heathen king to punish his own people and then turn around and whip the heathen king for touching his people. Do you understand that sometimes when it comes to us, that the Lord will allow us to be chastised? He might even use one of his enemies to do it. And then he'll turn around after that purpose has been realized, and he will punish his enemy for touching his child. Come on, say amen to that. Come on, say amen. Every time you go through something, you need to understand that God is in the midst of it. and that God allows it to happen. Otherwise, he would have prevented it. But it's for the purpose of not destroying us, but it's for the purpose of perfecting us. You see, Nebuchadnezzar was not content with controlling the leading cities of these lands. He also desired to control the thoughts and hearts of the people in the cities. Mind control was at the root of Babylon's strategy and world dominance. They not only wanted the land, but they wanted to control the minds of the ones that they were oppressing and that they were capturing. And even so today, brothers and sisters, everything that's going on around us, that the enemy has designed it for the purpose of mind control. Because if he can control your mind, then he can control you. Because as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Whatever you think about the most, that is what you are becoming. Come on, say amen. And so mind control, everything that we see, everything that we are exposed to is for the purpose of controlling the mind. The mind. And rather than forcing the ruling leaders of the conquered people of God to change, Nebuchadnezzar instead moved the best and brightest young people of the land to his palace. In so doing, he was taking a long-term view of his conquest. He knew that overcoming people by military force was not enough. If they continued to resist him, more and more of his resources would be demanded. He was not the last leader to realize that he was not the last leader to realize that capturing the hearts and minds of the young people would eventually capture these nations. In fact, no one did it better than Babylon since Lucifer's infiltration into the mind of Eve and Adam. Nobody did it better since Hitler's Mein Kampf in Nazi Germany and his growing press for mind control in the world today. Now, the experience of Daniel, this is what happened, and this is what I want you to listen to and understand. The first thing they thought about, that was put in place was isolation. Isolation. These young men were isolated from the influences that would mold their thinking and character in the ways of the Lord. I want you to think about that for a moment. You see, we might look at that and we might say, well, that doesn't apply to us. Yes, it does. You see, anything that will drive a wedge between us and the church and us and God in some form is the same type of situation that was employed by Babylon. Isolation. You see, you can become isolated when you decide that you are not going to get together. Nobody has to twist your arm. Nobody has to put you in prison. The only thing they have to do is create in your mind a reason why you should not come together. And we're seeing that more and more. When we look at the studies that talk about how things have changed since COVID, COVID did not start it. COVID simply revealed it. You see, we can mask, we can parade, we can go through the motions, which we did before COVID, and many places, churches were packed. And then in other places that had been stalwart and had been monumental in terms of their experience through the years in terms of attendance and service had since COVID had plummeted. Some of the churches, and all you need to do is ride around, and you can see that some of them are a barren wasteland. Now the wholeness will bear me out. I remember in Southeastern, even before COVID, long before COVID, when it came to actual membership on the books was high. But when you go to the churches and you see the real, not the ideal, who was on the membership, but when you see the real in the pew, there was a vast difference. A vast difference. Now you take that and put it on steroids with COVID, and you find that many churches, even during COVID, were in a quandary because they gambled even when COVID was at its height, realizing that if they did not open their doors, that financially they would be in ruin. They would be in ruin. I'm just telling you the truth this morning. But I'm telling you in a way that lets you know what the enemy was all about. Even in Daniel's day, the first thing was isolation. Isolation. And when we look around in a lot of the churches, young people are scarce. You have the very young ones, but somewhere in the middle. Somewhere in the middle, from the teens up to around 35. Doesn't matter what church you go to. There are a couple of churches in the area that are comprised of young people. But for the most part, not only here, but in the other conferences, Northeastern Conference and South Atlantic Conference and the other conferences, the young people are not there. Because the enemy is seeking to put them in a situation of isolation, to separate them, to cause them to be separated and not to be in place. And that's not to mean that all of them are just gone. No, I'm not talking about that. I'm just talking about the things that we are accustomed to. Are in a state of flux and are changing. And we have to realize that this is a part of the enemy's play. And here's the thing that I want you to understand, that they were separated from the regular public worship of God. Talking about the captives, they were separated from the regular public worship of God. From the teaching of the word of God and from the fellowship and wisdom of God's people. It's a part of the plan. Part of the plan. And if it ain't broke, the devil ain't trying to fix it. Come on, say amen. It's a part of the plan. The second thing, element that you need to understand was that there was also indoctrination. Notice the emphasis on learning the language and the literature of the Babylonians. That was not by chance. It was by design. This seems harmless, and there's nothing inherently wrong with learning foreign literature or languages. But in this case, the aim was not merely academic. Nebuchadnezzar wanted to retain their minds to think as Babylonians rather than as Israelites. To totally re-indoctrinate them so that eventually it plants a new seed of worldview. It changes the worldview. There's nothing wrong with having a broad perspective when it comes to worldview. Not at all. You need to broaden your horizon. You need to expand. No, the world is not just Orlando. Come on, say amen. You found many of you, when you came here from other countries, perhaps realize that there was something that was bigger than Jamaica. There was something that was bigger than Trinidad. There was something that was bigger than Grenada or wherever the case may be. I realized that when I left New Jersey that there was something bigger than New Jersey. I thought that New Jersey was all there was until I was able to get around and go places and see different things and realize that the world was bigger than that. And the world is bigger than what we think. And here it is that Babylon realized that if they were going to have their way, they're going to take the young people, the best and brightest. They were going to isolate them. They were going to they were going to pull them away from even from those who had some life experience. They were going to pull them away from church and the culture of church and the knowledge of their God, and was going to sacrifice them in that regard. Nebuchadnezzar knew that this was just a chain, a link in the chain, and that he was going to plant within them new seeds of a new worldview. And then compromise. Culture does not scream at us to change. It entices us with those things to which our undisciplined minds run after, our undisciplined appetites, as it were, and our desires are drawn. I want you to understand something. Sometimes we have limited this text dealing with what Daniel and the Hebrew worthies ate to be limited to food. We've reduced it to that. But there was something that when the culture deals with the undisciplined mind, that it deals sometimes with the appetites and desires, not just the food, but everything that goes along with the food. The food allotment was one of seduction. It was not Taco Bell, it wasn't even filet mignon. It was connecting the indoctrination of unbridled appetites and carnal desires with the different lifestyle, one that promised a lot more than it could deliver. Gluttony and overindulgence feeds the undisciplined soul that even at the end of the day is left starving. It is the tapeworm that infects the soul. Now, you know what it's like, or you've heard what it's like to have a tapeworm. You can eat and eat and eat and eat. And you ever met people that are so disgusting that when they can eat everything and don't gain a pound? And some of us, all we got to do is even look at it, and we're gaining. I want you to understand something. You know, when you, now, and bear me out on this. Here, if anybody should have been getting fat, it was those who ate from the king's table. He had everything on that table. Everything that you could think about. And yet the text says that when they looked at the Hebrew worthies, that the Hebrew worthies were thicker than those who ate everything. It wasn't just about the food. It was about the fact that when it came to overindulgence, that the chickens had come home to roost. Chickens had come home to roost. But I want to move forward because I got to hurry. But then there was a point of another thing was confusion. Confusion. The fourth element in the process of weaning these young men from the truth was the changing of their names. You see, all these things play together. Individually, they may not work out as well. But when they are placed collaboratively together, the isolation, the compromise, the indoctrination, and now the confusion, the changing of the name. You see, the name is not the name that you called, but it's the name that you answer to. It's the name that you answer to. Your mom and dad gave you a name. I remember during the 70s when, you know, there was an Afrocentric press to rid of slave names and to go back to our African heritage. Some of the names that were given to individuals, I wonder if mom and dad had a little bit too much to drink when they did it. I mean, it was like they threw the letters up in the air, and whatever came down on one side of the line, that's what the name of the child became. You know, I remember when my wife was working at Apopka High School, strange stories used to come out of Apopka High School. I know they don't come out of other schools, but, you know, she told me about some kids' names, and some of the names were really crazy. Some of the parents, and you can believe this if you want to, and I'm telling you the truth, I have no reason to tell you a story, were given names based on the vehicle that they were conceived in. That's what the child came to school and said. No wonder the child's messed up, all jacked up, because that's what they're answering to. And when they're asked to explain your name, you know, they say, well, that's where my mom and daddy conceived me, was in the back of a Mustang. Really? But I want you to think about it for a moment. It is nothing for you to listen to some music or so-called music where women are called out of their name. And it's not so bad. I mean, it's bad enough them being called out of their name, but they smile in answer to it. And if you hear something long enough, you begin to believe it. You begin to believe it. And so they become confused. These names, talking about the names of which these young men were renamed, would be used day after day in normal speech and would remind these young people of the direction in which they were headed. In which they were headed. Change the name, isolate you from that which you know, indoctrinate you with a different culture that is altogether not only foreign to God and anything that you've been taught about God, but it has a spin on it that is demonic. And there was Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego that were exposed to this. And then on top of that, were put in a position of compromise. They were Jews, after all. There were certain things that, according to the belief system in the God of Israel, that they did not do. They did not eat. They did not do any of those things. And yet, little by little, the play was to get them to compromise. But then, as I said, confusion. Confusion, you know the name that you were named, but you're hearing another name. You no longer hear the name that you were born with. And each of those names, both in the Babylonian culture and in the Israelite culture, each of those names were given, had a meaning to them. A meaning to them. And so the very meaning of your name has changed. And with the meaning of your name that has changed, and the more you hear it, you begin to act like it. You begin to behave like it. You begin to think like it. The principle, again, is simple. The way we think about God, the way we think about ourselves, the way we think about others and the world determines how we live and who we are. Dr. David Stoop, renowned Christian clinical psychologist, says this: you are what you think and what you think you are. If Nebuchadnezzar could get these young men to think like Babylonians, they would begin to live like Babylonians. And my brothers and sisters, that's exactly what we're seeing in the culture. Not by accident. It is by design. The reverse was also true. The less they thought of themselves as the Lord's people and his servants, the less they would live like people of God. You see, we're fortunate not to live in a totalitarian state under a tyrannical dictator into which Daniel was brought. Yet we are still confronted by this strategy. But I'm gonna move to close so I don't keep us too long. And that is that it is necessary, my brothers and sisters, it's necessary for us when we who live in a foreign culture that we must have a different attitude when it comes to the way we live. Come on, say amen. And so Daniel and his friends, even though they were in a cultural crunch, had to learn how to handle that situation and handle the conflicts within the culture. And the first thing they had to do was to develop firm convictions and resolutions. You heard Brother Danny's story today talking about no way out. That child had to come to the realization that you could not sit on the fence with your convictions and your resolutions. And the only way that you could have firm convictions and resolutions is that when you have an intimate relationship with your God, and when you allow anything to break the cord, to separate you, then you are on a pathway towards destruction. So you've got to develop firm convictions and resolutions. The second thing is you need to determine a wise approach to this immediate dilemma. You can't, nor can I, go willy-nilly through this world and through this life just wandering and just going through willy-nilly. You and I have to understand that we are in a war. It is not playing with cap guns. It's not playing even with paint. The kids go out and go paintball shooting. Well, you can get hit with a paintball. The only thing you get is paint on you. But when you get hit with the devil shot, you may not make it. And therefore, you have to learn how to defend yourself and how I have to defend myself. And because we wrestle not against flesh and blood. In case you forgot it, the devil is out for keeps. He wants to destroy us. He wants to destroy your family. He wants to take your children out. As a matter of fact, he wants to take you out and take me out. So we have to be sensitive to the fact that the culture is not our friend. That doesn't mean we have to walk around and be weird, but it does mean we need to walk around and have our eyes open and have our eyes focused on Jesus. Daniel didn't stage a protest or participate in the hunger strike. Once he had developed his convictions, he sought permission to go on a different course. Notice that he also gave a reason that he might not defile himself. Conviction and resolve without action becomes mere stubbornness. And my brothers and sisters, I'm convinced that Adventists are the most stubborn people in the whole wide world. And I'm not saying that against you. I'm saying that because I'm in the boat with you. We can be stubborn on certain things just for the purpose of being right. We have this innate tendency that we have to be right about everything. And that not only are we right, but if it didn't come from us, it is wrong. It is wrong. Conviction and resolve without action become stubbornness. Daniel was able to tell his polytheistic official the basis of his monotheistic belief. He acted with conviction, but with respect for authority, even ungodly authority. Notice it was not Daniel's convictions or beliefs that caused the initial refusal. It was the anxieties of this official. Then we have to refuse to retreat at the first sign of resistance. My brothers and sisters, those who live godly are going to suffer persecution. There's no question about that. Some of us are looking for persecution to come in big forms. Some of us are looking for persecution for us to be hauled before magistrates and those types of things. But you can suffer persecution without doing any of that. And I'm not talking about the persecution that we bring upon ourselves, because we do bring a lot of persecution upon ourselves. You will admit that. Come on, say amen. If you haven't said amen today, you need to say amen to that. We bring a lot of stuff on ourselves. And then we want to blame it on the fact, well, those who live godly will suffer persecution. No, sometimes you need to know when to shut up, and then you need to know when it's time to speak up. And sometimes we get it confused. The self-serving commander of the officials was not moved by Daniel's requests, but rather than responding with contempt, notice how Daniel did everything in tact and diplomacy. Didn't argue, didn't rise up in rebellion, you know, didn't even threaten to resign. Daniel stayed focused on his commitment with a creative and reasonable alternative. Daniel even allowed the overseer to be the judge of the outcome of the alternative. That was a humble confidence. Then he relied on divine assistance. There's the phrase that to be pondered, God gave them. Passing this test allowed Daniel to continue to live in harmony with his convictions. His obedience brought another benefit. God allowed him to have knowledge and wisdom about every aspect of that culture without being swallowed up by it. You see, sometimes we feel that if we read outside of the prescribed books, that we're going to be contaminated by our reading. That's not necessarily the case. Daniel had to know about the culture that he was at war against. in order. You, in other words, you can't speak about something that you're not knowledgeable about. The same God can protect you and keep you if you ask him, because you're not asking in order to for permission to go out and be wild. You want to know. And one of the things that as adults that we do not know enough, nor do we even want to hear about some of the things that the kids are going through. And then we expect them to listen to us just simply because we say, you shouldn't do that. You know, you need to have a reason for your faith. Come on, say amen. You don't need to be afraid, but you need to, you ask the Holy Spirit to lead you and guide you. And so that when you talk, you can talk intelligently to your young people, because young people, in case you didn't realize it, are different from when our generation was coming along. We could not even ask questions. It was simply my way or the highway. And that's the way it was. These are the rules in my house. And if you're going to live in my house, then you're going to live by my rules. And then when the children got of age, the things that you didn't want to talk about, they found out about, but they found out somewhere, and it wasn't in an environment in which you could manage. And some of us are suffering the results of that even today. And then what happens is, you begin to parent the way that you were parented. And it's like throwing dice, 50-50 chance of tossing a coin on which way things are going to turn out. But you've got to rely on the assistance of the divine in order to get through, in order to get through it. And then the last thing, and this is it. Honor. Honor God with your life over the long haul. You know, after they got through the 10 days, and they were proven that their countenance and their intelligence and everything was greater than their counterparts, they didn't go back with the intent on, now that I've gone through this test, I'm going to be a Babylonian. You know, some of us will get through a certain situation and we are pressing hard with the Lord to do something for us, and we're on fire for him to do something for us. And then after he does something for us, what do? We go back to the way we were. Not Daniel and them. They were in it for the long haul with the Lord. And that's how he made it through. And they made it through as prisoners of war. Prisoners of war, that they were able to be successful. And I don't have time to tell you how God used them by infiltrating the Babylonian kingdom and then raising them up in the kingdom, which was unheard of, to be spokesmen for God in high places. My brothers and sisters, one of the greatest prisoners of war was one by the name of John McCain. John McCain was the son and grandson of four-star admirals. In Vietnam, he was stripped of everything but his character. He boiled over in front of curses, foul curses of his captors. He was shot down over Hanoi, suffering broken arms and a shattered leg. Soldier. He was in solitary confinement for 2 years and beaten frequently. Often he was suspended by ropes, lashing his arms behind him. He attempted suicide twice. He went down to 105 pounds. He rejected early release to keep his honor and to avoid an enemy propaganda coup or risk demoralizing his fellow prisoners. He was permanently disabled. He was in captivity for 5.5 years. And yet, the record says that he never broke. Never broke. My brothers and sisters, you are a prisoner of war. And you're in the battle for your life. And the enemy is betting on the fact that you're going to break. He's betting on the fact that you are not going to be faithful in the end. He's betting on the fact that when he throws everything at you, that there's something that's going to capture you. There's something that's going to get you. And we spend so much time trying to battle little things. It is not the little things. The thing that we are challenged to do is hold on to our faith in Jesus Christ. It is not fighting the bad fight of sin. It is fighting the good fight of faith. And yet day in and day out, we fight the bad fight of faith. Instead of talking about the good news of salvation, we talk about the bad news. We need to adjust our focus. The thing that got John McCain through is that he stayed focused. The question today, will you stay focused? I can tell you how you can stay focused. Is you have to align yourself with Jesus Christ. Bigger than the church, you've got to be united with him in mission, seeking and saving lost souls. You've got to be connected with him in his death, burial, and resurrection. And you got to have a firm faith that one day he's coming back to get you. Coming back to save you. John McCain was rescued. He held on and did not give up. Today I'm imploring each of us to hold on and not give up. Daniel and the worthies, they held on, did not give up. You and I are in a similar strait, in a similar war. We cannot give up on him. Your head's about, your eyes are closed. I'm making a simple appeal today. You've seen the enemy's approach. Now he went in amongst God's people, pillaged, ravaged the place, and took the best of the best captive. You've seen how the things that they went through, but yet, even as young people, they held tight to their faith in God. And today, above all else, you say, Pastor, I know that we're living in difficult times. I know that we're living in challenging times. I know that the culture is corrupt. I know that the devil wants to take me out. But I want you to pray for me today that I will remain faithful until Jesus comes. That's the basis of the appeal. That's the earnestness within our hearts. That's our desire today. We want to be faithful when Jesus comes. If that's your desire, I invite you to stand to your feet because I want to pray for you. In this war, there are no ties. There are victors and there are losers. And today, you do not have to be a loser, because the fight is not yours. The battle is the Lord's, and he's already won. You want to be on the winning side. You want to belong to him. And so I'm praying now, Father, we need you, because we want to survive as prisoners of war. We realize that before the battle is all over, that we might be disabled. We might lose some things. We might lose an arm. We might lose a leg. We might lose an eye. Something might be lost. We might lose our lives on the battlefield. But it's okay, because even if we lose our lives, that's already been covered in the charter. He's already provided that if we die in him, that as he lives, we too will live. Some of us might lose a limb, but it's better to go limping into the kingdom than it is to be on the outside looking in. And so we're prepared to do whatever it takes in order for us to hold on to you and to realize salvation, the free gift that you've given to us. And I pray today for everyone under the sound of my voice that you would secure the victory in us, the confidence in you, that if we hold on to the end, we will be saved. And today we claim that, and we pray that you would seal this prayer with the Holy Spirit's presence and power, that we will be saved. Not we might, but that we will be saved, because we claim it and we ask it in Jesus' name. Let everybody say, amen, amen.
Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing. Oh, victory, oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved the air, I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood.
Church, let's stand as we pray. Dear Lord, we're so thankful for another opportunity. We've reached the end of the service, but we have not reached the end of the Sabbath. We have not reached the end of our relationship with you. So, Father, I ask that you take us into this next week and fill us with your Spirit right now and give us the strength to press on, Lord. Please help us to stand out like Daniel and his brethren, and please help us to not allow this world to control our minds. But Lord, please help us to let this mind be in us that's also in Christ Jesus. And please help us to surrender our reputation and the things that this world has told us to become. And Lord, we are surrendering that now because we just want to be like Jesus. So, Father, show us what it means to be like Jesus as we go throughout the week, and give us the Sabbath rest and replenish us as we continue to do your service. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Victory today is mine. Joy is mine. Joy is mine. Joy is mine. Joy today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Joy today is mine. Peace is mine. Peace is mine. Peace is mine. Peace today is mine. And I told Satan, get thee behind. Peace today is mine.
See you.